St. Anthony's. Today is the first Sunday of Advent.
Today's Mass is offered to celebrate the 50th wedding anniversary, Jim and Charlene Walton, and also for Alanna Miklic.
Let us take a minute to consciously acknowledge that we are in the presence of God and ask Him to help us to hear what He wants to say to us today. Advent is a time of waiting for the Lord and desiring to grow in His friendship and rise above the anxieties of daily life so as to remain in peaceful certainty before the Son of Man. In the first reading, during the siege of Jerusalem by the Babylonians, when all seemed lost, and it appeared that God had turned away from the chosen people, Jeremiah the prophet reassured his people that God had not forgotten them. In his time, God will raise up a descendant of David who will bring justice and peace to the land. The second reading is a prayer to a community who believes that the second coming of Christ is imminent. Paul prays that the Thessalonians grow in love for each other in preparation for the return of Jesus. He urges them to conduct themselves in a way pleasing to God. In today's gospel, Jesus speaks about the coming of the Son of Man at the end of the world. Using apocalyptic language, Jesus presents images of both cosmic and political upheaval. The unrighteous will be terrified by these events, but faithful disciples of Jesus need not fear, for the coming of the Son of Man will signal their deliverance and salvation. Jesus exhorts his followers to be on guard, lest they fall into self-indulgence and forget God and his ways. For the faithful disciple, the coming of the Son of Man will not be a fearful event. Rather, it will be a day of triumph and joy. Let us pray. O Lord of justice, your coming overthrows all that is not ruled by you. Increase our longing for you and give us the strength to grow in love, that the dawn of your coming may find us rejoicing in your presence and welcoming the light of your truth. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Our opening hymn is number 46, The King Shall Come When Morning Dawns, number 46.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
my brothers and sisters, today we celebrate another great day. Advent, first week of Advent, where we're called to hope and expect the arrival of the Lord. Let us pause for a moment to reflect the times of our lives when our hearts are unprepared, when our hearts are filled with worries, anxiety, and things that keep us from God from entering fully into our life. For these times, let us ask the Lord for his hard mercy. Lord Jesus, you give us hope. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you strengthen us with faith. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you prepare us for your return. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Grant your faithful, we pray, Almighty God, the resolve to run forth to meet your Christ with righteous deeds at his coming, so that gather at his right hand, they may be worthy to possess the heavenly kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The days are coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and Judah. In those days, in that time, I will raise up for David a just shoot. He shall do what is right and just in the land. In those days, Judah shall be safe, and Jerusalem shall dwell secure. This is what they shall call her, the Lord, our justice. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
From the first letter of Thessalonians. Brothers and sisters, may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, just as we have for you, so as to strengthen your hearts to be blameless in holiness before our God and Father, at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all his holy ones. Amen. Finally, brothers and sisters, we earnestly ask and exhort you in the Lord Jesus that as you have received from us how you should conduct yourselves to please God, and as you are conducting yourselves, you do so even more. For you know what instructions we gave you through the Lord Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Upon the world, for the powers of heaven will be shaken, and then they will see the Son of Man coming in the cloud with power and great power. When these signs begin to happen, stand erect and raise your head, because your redemption is at hand. Beware that your hearts do not become drowsy from carousing and drunkenness and the anxieties of daily life. That day catch you by surprise like a trap, for that day will assault everyone who lives on the face of the earth. Be vigilant at all times. Pray that you have the strength to escape the tribulation that are imminent and to stand before the Son of Man. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
What do you do when you're expecting a child? Do you just sort of wait? Okay, now it's 9 months. I'll just wait for 9 months and I'll have a child in 9 months.
They get the room ready, get the clothes ready.
Okay, you get ready by how?
Preparing for them to come. Or having space for them, a place for them to sleep, food, all that other stuff if they need.
Okay, all the logistics, but what else so inside of you? What goes on?
Nutrition. Changes in your body.
Yeah. Okay, changes your body. What about your identity? And how it will affect your life from that moment onward? Because as soon as you find the news, does your identity change?
Yeah, you're going to be a mother.
Yeah, you're going to be a mother or father. And also you worry about what happens afterward, and you look ahead. How is this going to change my life, and how is it going to affect other children if it's not your first child? Or if you had miscarriage before, are you filled with anxiety and worry?
You bet.
Yeah. Oh yeah, even more so. You're probably very afraid, like, I don't know. I'm so afraid maybe this one won't turn out well. It'll be a great expectation, but end up in huge disappointment and sadness.
And so you're probably very, I would imagine, very worried. And you know, Advent is a season like that. We're waiting, we're expecting. We know the Lord arrived 2,000 years ago. But in a sense, every year is different. Think about it. Every time you guys have a child, is it the same experience? You've been there, done that?
Yeah. Are we all different?
They're all different. How? A child is a child. So tell me, how is it different, Karen?
Sometimes the labor is different.
The what?
When you're in labor, it's different. First child might be a few hours, and the next one might be more.
Okay, I'll take your word for that. But I mean, but it's also different too because the situation is different. Perhaps you've been a little, obviously a bit older now. So your experience of life is different. Your expectation is different, I would imagine, right? You have more experience under your belt now. And of course, your life situation is different. So you approach it differently. Because I would imagine the first time, the first child you would have, you did the research, you probably did everything by textbook, didn't you? Probably Dr. Spock, that you read pretty well backward and forward. And what happens to that book, the second child and the third child and the fourth child?
Dust.
It's dust.
Dust.
Why? What happened to that book? Is it not legit anymore?
You don't have time to
read it. Okay, number one, you don't have time.
And you've already learned what the book was right about and what it wasn't, so you know, you don't...
It's in black and white, could be wrong.
It can be wrong.
Okay.
The biggest thing, especially after the second one, going to the third one, is, you know, what's the personality going to be like? Because one and two were night and day.
Is your voice cracking up? Are you getting emotional, Tim?
No.
I'm just curious.
No, but they were night and day, so then you wonder, oh man, if the third one comes out like the second, we're not going to live through this.
Do you agree with that, Teresa?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. But I mean, there's different changes. And every year, you know, we celebrate Christmas. It's not the same Christmas, even though it's the same Christ. Christ is the same, but we are different now. And you know, sometimes I'm just kind of curious that we get caught by surprise. I don't know about you, but this year, like every year, even more so this year, it just feels like, oh my gosh, it's already Christmas. I'm being still in shock over it, admittedly. And you know, some of us, you know, for Christmas, how do we prepare for Christmas?
Shopping.
Yeah, the trees, the shopping, the Christmas lights, and some of us are so more efficient. We just leave our Christmas lights up from last year, don't we? Admit it. Yeah, we know who we are. Or some of us might even have the Christmas tree from last year. We could say, oh, what's the heck? What's the point? It's still, you know, if I take it down next year, I'll have to put it up again. Mm-hmm. And we go through this motion that we forget behind all this labor, all this work, is something even more important. It's the birth of Christ. It means it has to change our life. We have to reflect upon it. Because to prepare and to await is like the pregnancy birth. You just don't sort of, okay, now it's 9 months. Do you?
No.
No, it's about your worries, your hope, all that becomes alive, all that hope and dreams become, the fear become, you know, prevalent and real in your life. It's the same with Jesus that, you know, we can't, it's not more than just the trees, the reindeer, and all this thing, which is nice, but the meaning behind it, it has to be Jesus. If it's not, does it have any meaning?
No,
it's just a season of greeting that we make, we do ourselves feel good. And if that's true, then why don't we do it every weekly, every monthly? We all need a good picker upper, don't we? Yeah. If that's true on a quarterly basis. But it's something that is uniquely our experience in life that we're called into this deep preparation for Jesus. And this preparation to have Jesus relevant in your life, what needs to happen? What needs to happen?
You need to love him.
Yeah, love him, but also
have a
relationship. And sometimes in life, as we get closer to Christmas, what tends to happen to us?
Forget about him.
Forget about it? Okay, well, that's one possibility.
There's so much else going on that you tend to push it towards.
That's right. There's so many pressure. Family, travel, COVID, new variant, etc. And, you know, you get all that anxiety and worry in there that you forget, that we then forget what is the purpose and the meaning of Christmas. That we forget, you know, ultimately, it's about Jesus. It's more than just my fear and worries. And I need to focus on Jesus in my life for it to mean something, for it to change and transform me. And oftentimes, you know, we forget that to prepare a room for Jesus as you prepare room for a child, what needs to happen?
You have to prepare for Jesus.
Yes, you have to prepare for Jesus. Think about it. When you have a child, do you automatically assume that in 9 months the house will be ready?
No.
No, you have to get the cribs. If it's your not your first child, second or third, you get the baby clothing out. You figure, what do I need? You know, to get this ready when the child comes, there'll be room for the child in the house. And of course, if you have other children, you have to psychologically prepare them. Now, you have to, hopefully you would tell them the news instead of that day. Yeah. By the way, you're having a sister. Yeah. You know, you would prepare them as you would prepare your own heart and your life. And the same thing with Jesus in our life. To have Jesus in our life, we are called to prepare room for him in our life. And there's no room for Jesus if there is sin and worries and anxiety of the world that wrapped up our heart. And I don't know about you, but how do you get rid of this anxiety, the worries, and the sin in your life?
Prayer.
Tell Jesus you trust in him and keep going.
Okay, tell Jesus, but what else?
Confession.
Yeah, go to confession. Tell to God what you're sorry for, what the things that keep you from embracing him in your life. I don't know how many of you in your life, when you talk to someone and you have so much anxiety and worries, or you have something else on your mind, that when they're talking to you, your mind is somewhere else, you're thinking about something else. Mm-hmm. And when you're doing that, are you truly present for the person?
No.
No, you're not, because your mind and heart is somewhere else. You're not connected with the person because you are somewhere else. And the same thing with Jesus in our life. If we want room for him, we have to remove these fears, these worries, and these distractions of our heart. Is that an easy thing to do?
No.
No, it's a very difficult thing to do. Why is it so difficult? Why is it so difficult?
We let outside influences and occupy our minds with stuff that is trivial.
Yes, but what also happens when we try to push them away? Do they come back?
Yes.
Sometimes there are dreams, our thoughts, our worries still creeping back and back and back.
All the time.
All the time. And as a result, we don't have room for Jesus in our life. And we're called in our life to prepare room for Jesus. That's what Advent is about. The church knows about this. That's why we have how many weeks of Advent?
Four.
We have roughly 4 weeks to prepare our hearts to it. And that's the reality of the human condition, that we need time. And it's not going to be an easy journey if we really take it seriously to have room for Jesus in our life. And anytime, you know, you approach life, every time you have a new change in your life, does it require a lot of preparation in your mind and set so that you can worthily, so that you can truly enter into the mystery of what you're doing?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, it doesn't just happen. And you know, in today's reading, you hear about the gospel, how people are deathly afraid. They just die of fright. Mm-hmm. And what is Jesus telling us to do?
Stand erect.
And do what?
Get ready for him.
Because the fears and the worries going to come to you, barrage you constantly. And yet in the midst of all this, stand erect despite the world seems to be falling around you. Stand erect. And the gospel concludes, the gospel of the Lord, your response was?
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Now in the midst of the world falling apart, how do you have the courage to stand erect and praise the Lord?
Faith.
Yes, your faith. That, does that happen by accident?
No.
No, it's an intentional act in your life. That every time you go to church, that's you are affirming your faith and getting help from God in your life. To say, yeah, Lord, I need your help in my life. I need to receive you in my life. I am not going to allow my fear, my worry to keep me away from you. That you, Lord, I need you in my life. I surrender myself to you. And if you think about it, every day, every year is another day closer to the Lord. Or at least it should be. That's if we don't allow our fears and worries to overwhelm us. And today, my brothers and sisters, I just invite you to open your minds and your heart so that you can truly receive the Lord in your life. And I know it's not going to be easy. I know some of you probably haven't gone to confession for a while. And if you haven't gone to confession for a while, is it going to be a scary experience?
Yeah.
Yes, you're probably dreading it. Oh, no. It sounds great in theory. And it's, you know, in life, it's kind of funny in life. It's very easy to think that we're good and kind. And, you know, we're really a decent person. I mean, we're really not, we're not bad, bad, but, you know, we're not a terrible person. Oh, we don't have any real thing to work on. But you know the amazing grace of our marriage is what? When you're living with somebody,
they'll let you know.
They'll let you know. They see all aspects of you. You can't hide it. And that's why sometimes I feel like, oh my gosh, it's so great for living with two dogs. They don't tell anybody. They can put up with me pretty good. But with people, they see all aspects of you. And it's very humbling when you think about it. They see things you think you can hide from everybody else. But when you live with somebody, they see all aspects of you. As God really sees all aspects, all parts of our life. Things we want to even keep hidden. But guess what? The mystery of it, even though he sees us as we are, does he still love you?
Yes.
Yes, and that's a proud, happy thing to say. Yes, he still loves me. He still accepts me. But yet, because he loved me so much, he wants me to be better. He wants me to be close to him. He wants me to get rid of these things that keep me away from him. Mm-hmm. He wants me to be vulnerable to him as he is vulnerable to me in each Eucharist. And so today, my brothers and sisters, I just invite you to have courage and think about your own life. And, you know, take some solid action in your life. Take some risk. Because when you do so, that's where the real changes happen in your life. When you allow yourself to be vulnerable, when you're willing to take risk and allow the Lord in your life. And I know it's not easy. It's going to be challenging. It's going to be scary. But you know, in the midst of change and scariness in life is where change happens in our life. And I just invite you, my brothers and sisters, as we approach, enter into the season of Advent, not to be filled with fear and worries like I suspect that many areas of the world is right now, but to stand proud, erect, and know that the Lord is with you, that you welcome him with joy and peace in your heart, that in doing so, may you and I be an example for one another in our witness of Christ to one another.
Amen. Amen.
My brothers and sisters, let us together profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us then and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life,
who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We humbly place our prayers before our compassionate God.
For all of us, as we begin this season of Advent, may it be a time of renewal and blessing as we prepare our hearts for the return of Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our Holy Father, Pope Francis, our bishops, and all who exercise authority in the Church, may they be alert to the signs of the times and continue to inspire us to work in the ways of the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who live in nations torn apart by ethnic unrest and division, may peace and reconciliation reign in their homes and communities. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who struggle to find meaning and direction in their lives, may we, who await the return of Christ, shine forth as a beacon of light and hope in their search. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That people everywhere recognize God's presence in the world and thank Him for every benefit. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who are suffering, as Christ did on the cross, find in it a hidden treasure and offer it to God for the good of others. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That this gathering of Christians learn to praise and thank God at all times, entrusting every difficulty to Him. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died marked with the sign of faith, may they enter into eternal life with all the angels and saints in heaven. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our own personal and special intentions, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Lord God, your Church joyfully await the coming of its Savior, who enlighten our hearts and dispel the darkness of ignorance and sin. Pour forth your blessing upon us as we light the candles of this wreath. May their light reflect the splendor of Christ, who is Lord forever and ever.
Amen.
Our presentation of gifts hymn is number 65, Come Lord Maranatha, and we'll do the week one verses.
Now is the time to wake from sleep, salvation is close at hand. Into day, lift up your voices.
pray, dearly beloved, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Accept, we pray, O Lord, these offerings we make, gather from among your gifts to us, and may what you grant us to celebrate devoutly here below gain for us the prize of eternal redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks, O Lord, our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he assumed at his first coming the lowliness of human flesh, and so fulfilled the design you formed long ago, and opened for us the way to eternal salvation, that when he comes again in glory and majesty, all is at last made manifest. We who watch for that day may inherit the great promise in which we now dare to hope. And so, with the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as if our end we acclaim. Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is a chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy
to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church. Spread throughout the world and bring her into the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, and Alexander, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, and with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be called heir to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance of your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen. And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other some peace.
Healed. The Lord will bestow his bounty, and our earth shall yield its increase.
Our communion song is number 332, Taste and See.
Every month, you're perfectly welcome to do that. And many thanks for generosity for your contribution to our parish. You know, COVID time has been very tough on parishes in general for us too, but thank you for the continued contribution in that regard. Also, remember, we're called to give testimony to each other. Every wedding anniversary, when you make another anniversary, you've made it to another year. Is that a witness in of itself?
Yes.
It is. How?
It can be done.
It can be done. Not by, well, some of my perseverance, I had to laugh at Tim a while ago, like,
Was your prayer at the third child like, oh God, please don't make my third child like my first one. Hopefully he is a lot better. It's the second one drove me almost insane.
Yeah.
I gotta meet your second one, by the way, one of these days. But I mean,
he's a whole different person as an adult than he was as a kid, I'll tell you that. Yeah.
So he's a lot better now?
Oh yeah. He's incredible now.
Okay, good. Glad to hear that. Yeah. But I mean, all that is our fears and our life coming together. You know, oftentimes our fear is a lot worse than the reality. Maybe with perseverance, maybe by God's grace, all that came together that he's a better person.
Yeah.
But you know, that's what life is about. You trust and you believe in God. So I just invite you to give testimony, to give your witness to one another. Because in our life, God is always there. And sometimes, you know, it's easy to feel overwhelmed and we forget that we think we're the only one who struggle with child rearing or marriage problems or whatever else we are. And of course, when we hear about other people's struggles, how does that help you?
Let you know you're not alone.
Let you know that you're not alone, right? You're not alone, that somebody else is also struggling with. Misery loves company, right?
Yeah.
No, I'm kidding aside. It also gives you courage and strength. Like, yeah, this person did it. If Tim can do it, I'm sure anyone else can do it too.
Yeah.
No, I'm kidding. But I mean, you know, it gives you hope. So I just invite you to continue to give your testimony. And many thanks for those that have generously shared your story so far. It's really helped us to get to know each other and encourage each other and be strengthened by your testimony. Also, if you have upcoming wedding anniversary, don't be shy. Let us celebrate with you together with an anniversary mass and also with the picture of your wedding and a current picture. And if you notice how wedding anniversary goes by, every year gets by, another year goes by, what tends to happen to us? You get older, but you tend to take it not so seriously anymore. Right. Oh, it's another year.
No.
Like sometimes you do that, don't you?
Not for a wedding anniversary.
Okay, not for birthdays. But sometimes, you know, we just sort of let it go by, and that's a tragedy. We should really commemorate, because that's another year of God working in our life. Because I say that, because oftentimes, you know, I see a newly married couple, you know what, the first thing you see when you come to their house, what do you see?
Wedding pictures,
sometimes life-size picture, believe it or not, big pictures. But what happened by third, fourth, fifth year? It disappeared. And hopefully there's a place with kids' picture and all that, the other picture. But sometimes, you know, it loses its joy and splendor in it, you know? So sometimes we forget that, which I'm glad that Aggie's not, obviously not.
My original wedding picture and my 50th anniversary are right side by side on the buffet.
Wow, okay, that's great. Well, there you go, that it's important to celebrate. Also, remember, online bulletins are available each week, so be sure to use that, the wonderful online bulletin, because you know why you should use it? It's award-winning, and it's written by our own Bulletin Award winner, Pam Lamphere. So when you see her, continue to thank her for her hard, hard work. Let us pray. May these mysteries, O Lord, which we have participated, profit us, we pray. For even now, as we walk amid passing things, you teach us by them to love things of heaven and to hold fast to what endures through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May the Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in peace and love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle.
Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who wander about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.
Our closing hymn is number 388, City of God. And we'll do verses 1 and 2. Number 388. Thank you.
Let us build.